Okay, we are rolling.
Yeah.
Yes, hello.
Brody Stevens is maybe the most beloved comedian in Los Angeles. There's nobody who dislikes Brody Stevens other than maybe Brody Stevens. I fell in love with Brody at the Improv, I don't know, 10 years ago. He was hosting the show, and he was about 2 minutes into his act and just turned on the audience and told them he didn't need to put up with any of their crap because he just had a meeting with Jimmy Miller, who was interested in him. And they didn't know who Jimmy Miller was. And then he explained Jimmy Miller is Jim Carrey's manager, so you don't need this. And then he complained about management of the Improv and the lighting and the sound system and the waitresses and the lineup. And I thought, this is somebody I could be friendly with. Please welcome to the show my beloved Brody Stevens. Hello, sir.
Yes, thank you for that great intro. Hello, David. I would say that you described that pretty vividly, accurately. Yeah, I get on, you know, I just feel that I've lived such a troubling life before comedy, in comedy, that I just can't take the audience going again. You're going to add to that? No, that's not going to happen. I've been beaten down too much. Now I'm fighting back. And a lot of times the audience is like, they're neutral. They don't realize they're in the middle of it. I don't know who I'm going after, but the audience gets the brunt of it.
Can I give you a compliment and then we'll get serious or funny or whatever you want?
Sure.
Okay. You had one of the most impossible jobs in Hollywood. That is a warm-up act for television shows. Nobody,
yes.
Very few comedians make the leap from warming up a television audience to being an edgy comedian and appearing on television, because conventional wisdom is it's two separate animals. Warming up an audience for a TV show and then appearing on a TV show, two separate things. You seamlessly transferred from warming up a TV audience to starring and appearing on television. Why is that?
Well, I think people thought it was funny, maybe. You know, they saw me doing the warm-up. Yes, warm-up is very hard. I was just good at it. I was almost too good at it where I continued to do it. And, you know, I was able to do stand-up also. But it was, I was burning, you know, you had to really watch it, burning the candle at both ends.
Mm-hmm.
So, but somehow, I think just being around it so much and being in front of cameras, I was able to, you know, I could separate it. I was still a stand-up comedian. But
right.
When I did warm-up, I was there to do my job, which is never, you know, to warm up the crowd, make the comedians on the show have the most real experience, because I've been on shows. I could relate to them. I know what it's like when the audience is phony. So I would take care of the comedians. Let's make this real. And
uh-huh.
I think that, you know, comedians appreciated that. It made for a better TV taping. It looked better. So, you know, I did like 3,000 TV shows, but I kind of grown out of it, which is a good thing, but it's painful. It's a hard job. You grow, but the job stays the same.
Wow.
And then you go to another show, and now you got to start all over with these producers or a stage manager, and it just became, you know, harder for me. But I grew out of it. But I still feel like it's a good skill, and it's fun to do when you're on the right platform there.
Yeah, I want to stay with this, but first I want my audience to know who you are, because we have listeners all over the world, and some of these people don't follow comedy and don't know how beloved you are. You've appeared on Late Night, on NBC, Jimmy Kimmel, Premium Blend, The Late Late Show on CBS, The Late World, Late World with Zach, The Best Damn Sports Show, period, Children's Hospital, Tosh.0, Fox NFL.
Hangover 1, Hangover 2.
Yeah, I'm getting to the movies.
I'm sorry. I just jumped ahead. Whoa.
Hangover 1, Hangover 2, Jesus is Magic, I Am Comic. You had your own series on HBO Go. And The Police Are Coming for Us. You're sitting outside a Starbucks where 3 years
ago... Well, I moved in the neighborhood. I thought it would be quiet, or I moved down the street in the neighborhood.
That's okay. And Comedy Central's Brody Stevens, enjoy it. But I want to get back to warming up an audience. You've also done warm-up for the Best Damn Sports Show, Late World with Zach, The Man Show, Chelsea Lately, The Burn with Jeff Ross, The Jeselnik Offensive, Ridiculousness, Who Gets the Last Laugh, At Midnight, and Why with Hannibal Buress. I think warming up an audience as a stand-up comic is a kamikaze mission, because then I'll be quiet and I want you to react to this. And you kind of talked about it, but this is why I have so much respect for you. When I was working on one of the shows that you did the warm-up, the comedy writers would all rush down to see you do the warm-up. I've never experienced that before, where we all went down to watch the warm-up guy, the guy getting the TV audience in the mood for the show. And that's the baton death march, because you're trying to please 12 different masters when you're warming up a television show. You're trying to please the host, who doesn't want you killing. He wants you warming them up. He doesn't want you boiling them over. Then there are the network executives who have no idea who you are, what you're doing, and automatically dislike you because you're the warm-up guy. Then you have the audience who you're servicing. You've got to keep them happy. Things go wrong during a television taping. There are stops and starts. You have to be in the moment, quick, spontaneous. You turned it into an EST meeting. Somehow you turned it into a Tony Robbins Awake the Giant Within, and everybody left the show feeling better. You were like a Tony. It was like a Tony Robbins event, right?
Yeah, I mean, I think there's elements of that, definitely. I mean, I saw the benefits of having an audience sitting up, engaged, focused, energy. You know, I learned that at Best Damn Sports Show. That was my first gig back in 2001. It was my first real... I had done stand-up on TV at that point. I'd been on did CBS Late Show, and I did a Comedy Central Premium Blend as a stand-up. And then I had a friend who was writing on this Saturday Night Live meet sports show, mm-hmm. and they brought me in for the test show to do the warm-up, and they brought me in, and they ended up going with the show. And for me, it was like, whoa, I get to be on the Fox lot and mm-hmm. see all these great baseball players, Willie Mays, you know, Ernie Banks, Pete Rose, all the great athletes, they come through. So it was me having a sports background. I loved it. So it was my first paid gig, which I wasn't paid much. But that's where I learned energy, because it was a sports show, and I come from a sports background. I played baseball in college at Arizona State, and back in the 1988, when I was there, we were at Arizona State, we were learning about the mental energy from the baseball guys, the mental game of baseball. That's one reason why I went to school out in Arizona, because all the Major League Baseball teams were training there, and I wanted to be around that, be around baseball. But when we started learning the mental skills approach about being positive, and I had a chance, it took 6 years into my comedy when I did the warm-up and I was around the sports show bringing positive energy, because I would have football teams in there. I had every high school football team in mm-hmm. LA, and the kids would be like slouching over. I go, guys, we got to bring it. You got to sit up. Let's go. And the coaches would laugh like, you're laughing. See, see, the coaches would love it, and it made the show better. It actually, you're entertaining the crew. Also, the camera guys don't want to hear the same stuff. So you're making fun of the audience, but you're also doing a good job.
Yeah,
it's fun, and you can be satisfied.
Well, yeah, the idea of a comedy show. I mean, the writers, first of all, we're the most miserable human beings on the planet. So by the time the show starts, we're dead. We're dead inside. Now our bodies are dead. We show up to watch you, and all of a sudden we're getting this pep talk. You never see that in television. Nobody peps up an audience and tells them to remain positive. And then you keep complimenting everybody throughout the show.
Well, yeah, Radium, good job. We need a little more energy, second segment. Let's push it. You're good. A little more from you. It's just reading. It's reading them. Being, yeah. Here's the other thing. For me, I'm coming in at 2 o'clock with fresh energy. So I'm that second shift, and I just like, yeah, wake everybody up and get them going for dinner.
Do you mind if we talk about baseball? Because you may be tired of discussing it, but I might come to you from a different angle. So can we talk about baseball?
Sure.
You wanted to be a professional pitcher. You went to Arizona State. Your goal in life is to play professional baseball. You hang out with professional baseball players. Those are your true idols.
I would say yes. I get nervous around baseball players. If you have one at bat in the major leagues, I'm nervous around you.
And my influence is boxing. I view stand-up as a boxing match. But you're a pitcher. So you're coming at stand-up with a whole different mindset. Is that a fair statement?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm pitching up there. I mean, I'm pretty, like I say, I'm one-dimensional. But, yeah, everything's like straightforward, push through. But, yeah, sometimes you got to flip in a strike. Sometimes you got to throw one in the dirt, chase them. But, yeah, it's at the same. I think my mindset, I'm so in the moment. I can't, like, not help myself. That was the same thing with warm-up. It's like when I'm, I don't know if that's a good or bad thing, but I'm kind of like, you give me one task, and I'm zoned in on it. Maybe
okay.
It's
all right. So,
form
do you
of
mind?
Asperger's. I don't know.
Do you mind if I stay down this this neural pathway is where I want to go for a little while with you. Do you mind?
Okay. I'll follow. Yes. No, I don't. I do not.
Thank you. Thank you. I want to compare you for a second to me because my dad and I used to have catches when I was a kid, and Little League was very traumatic for me. I never understood baseball. I was bad at baseball. I was good at basketball, bad at baseball. I wanted to be a pitcher, and I never knew until recently that when a pitcher, I know this sounds ridiculous to you, I never knew that a pitcher could place the ball. A professional pitcher. I never knew that a pitcher had a strike zone and was hitting corners and could throw it precisely where he wanted to throw it. I didn't know that until recently. So as a pitcher, you are a lefty, I believe?
No, I'm right-handed.
Oh, you're a right-handed.
I play drums left-handed.
You play, okay. But you hold the microphone with your right hand, so I assumed you were a lefty.
No, I'm right-handed.
I'm joking. Do you know what hand you hold the microphone with?
Honestly, usually the left hand, even though I'm right-handed.
And what was there a decision to hold it with your left hand? Do you ever switch up? You ever hold it with your right?
No, I hold my phone with my left. I hold my. I feel like I have more finesse with my left hand.
Now, have you heard about this?
A little looser.
Have you heard about this kid coming out of Seattle? He's a switch holder. He can hold a microphone in his left and his right.
That's funny.
I don't know.
That's funny.
Okay. Let me ask you about your pitching career. When did you first play Little League?
1979.
So you were 9 years old. You were in
Tarzana.
You were 9 years old.
Yeah.
What position did you play?
Pitcher.
Immediately, you were a pitcher.
Right into it.
When did you know you wanted to be a pitcher?
When I was just striking guys out, it was fun to throw the ball and strike players out. I mean, I played first base, too. When you're little league, you play all the positions. I play a little first base, a little left field, but pitching was my thing.
Before Little League, was there Sandlot baseball going on?
No, I just was into trucks, breaking things.
Before Little League, before organized Little League, did you have?
Yeah, I had extra energy. Just honestly, like maybe riding bikes a little bit or breaking a couple things, like just the doctor, whoever told my mom, like, let them play Little League. So
you had not, but before organized Little League, you had not discovered that you wanted to be a pitcher.
No, but I liked the Dodgers. My first baseball game was 1977. So that's when I started getting into baseball. I grew up with the Dodgers, and I would watch them against, you know, the Yankees in the World Series. So
who introduced you to baseball?
Probably my dad. And then my mom took over for the most part. My dad would be at all my baseball games. My parents were separated, but divorced. But my dad was into baseball. He took me to Angel games and Oakland A games, because we lived up in the Sacramento for a while. He took me to Reno, take me to minor league baseball stadiums. So, and I think I remember just going to Dodger Stadium and being around the atmosphere. So I was really into that. And then I think just playing baseball, I had a strong arm, and it was fun to strike guys out. So I just was a good pitcher in terms of like blowing hitters away, but I was wild. I would hit guys, not on purpose, but I always just thought like a pitcher. I mean, that's how it is. You don't know. Like you, it's weird. Like you're either a pitcher or you're a hitter. I mean, some guys do both, of course, growing up, but I was always a pitcher. You know, that's kind of my way. I wasn't into sliding. I wasn't into running the bases. I'm not even into strategy. I'm just like, because it was one-on-one. I wanted to strike the guy out. I think that's what a lot of pitchers do, and that's a problem instead of getting them to hit a ground ball maybe. But I was just able, yeah.
How old were you in Little League when you were doing more than just throwing the ball over the plate?
Pitching, are you speaking about?
Yeah, yeah. Are you,
when did I learn about how to become a pitcher?
Yeah, when did you...
As opposed to a thrower?
When one of the joys of having children is Little League. I hate to sound... I don't even want to go down that path, but some of the happiest moments of my life are watching my kids play Little League. And one of the things I noticed is things you take for granted in watching baseball, when you watch Little League, when you watch 10-year-olds, just, you know, somebody hitting the ball to the shortstop and the shortstop throwing the guy out at first, it's a miracle. If a kid can do that at 9, it's like watching Lindbergh land in France. I mean, it's just an amazing accomplishment. It just looks so easy on television or at a major league game. But it's truly impossible for a 9-year-old to pull that off. As for the pitchers, were you able to place the ball? Were you able to look at the strike zone? What age were you saying to yourself, I'm going to throw this high and inside?
When I became an all-star in Little League.
What age?
That was 1982, so I was 12. And I learned from a former major leaguer, and from the all-star coach, also taught me how to throw a changeup. He taught me how to pitch a little bit. You don't have to strike everybody out. Here's a little, put a little wrinkle on it. Because all I threw was fastballs. And then I got with him for the all-stars, and he taught me how to pitch a little bit. Told me, you know, he was big into the changeup. So that's when I started. You know, I just worked on throw a fastball and then throw a changeup. And then when I got into maybe, when I was like 14, then I started throwing a curveball a little more.
Okay, what is a changeup? What is a changeup?
A changeup is basically just a slow pitch. You think it's going to be, you know, you have the same arm action. You hold it different in your hand, but they think it's a fastball and it's slow. So if you're throwing, you know, 88 all the time, and then you throw a pitch, same arm action, and they think it's going to be 88, but it ends up being 81, their timing's all off.
Their timing is off.
You don't have, yeah, their timing's off.
And they're going to pull, if even if they make contact, they're going to pull the ball.
Yeah, probably. Yeah, they might not do a lot unless you hang it. I mean, that's the thing. It's dangerous. Like, if you throw a curveball and it's a slow hanger, they can crush it. I mean, they can hit anything these days, but it's a changeup. You don't think about, are they going to pull? You're throwing a changeup to usually strike a guy out, or maybe usually to strike a guy out, I would say. So you're not trying to, like, get a ground ball with a changeup. You're trying to get a ground ball with, like, a sinker, which is a fastball that kind of moves down. So when you think about a ground ball, like, your instincts are right. Like, oh, he's going to pull it. But the only time you think, like, he's going to pull it is, like, when you want a double play. And usually if you want a double play, you're going to throw a two-seam fastball, which is a ball that sinks.
Okay, so but this isn't Little League, is it? This is very sophisticated stuff.
This is the growth out of Little League. This goes from, it comes quick. You know, you go from that Little League, and then you go to seniors. Now the mound's further back, and now you're in high school. And these kids in high school these days, they train like major leaguers. They're better now than they just have better training programs now, but. For me, it was still learning the changeup, changing speeds. You don't have to overpower guys. So then I learned the breaking ball later on. But first, it was changing speeds.
Before you get to, you went to Arizona State for pitching.
Correct.
I want to stay in Little League. I want to stay in Little League for a second.
Okay, back to Little League.
Because I followed Little League. That was my passion. When my kids were in Little League, that was, it might as well have been, you know, the 61 Yankees. Were the 61 Yankees great? I don't know.
27 Yankees.
The 27.
The greatest.
The 69 Mets. The 69 Mets.
There you go.
That's Little League to me is the 69 Mets, because you cannot believe, as I remember the 69 Mets, you couldn't believe they were actually winning, and it was all teamwork. There were really no standout. Well, anyway, but let me get back to Little League. So you got a kid 12 years old pitching. What does he have? He has a fastball, right?
Yep.
He doesn't have a changeup, does he?
Yeah, he does. A 12-year-old in 1982?
He has a changeup.
Yeah, he's got a changeup.
But does that affect the timing on these little leaguers? They're just trying to make contact with the ball, right? I mean,
I'm talking all-stars. Little league? I mean, basic little league?
Yeah.
Yes, there's guys who just, they only have one pitch. And that's why maybe they're not that good, or I say when you're 12, these days is when you start, they're throwing curveballs at 12.
In Little League or in all-star games?
I would say a little bit of both, but when I played, it was in all-star games. So, yes, obviously the all-stars are better. And I'm saying these days, the kids get better training and there's just better, I think it's training is what it is, and just better knowledge and better nutrition. So these kids are good.
Hang on for one second. I'm kind of amazed by this.
Okay.
You start playing Little League when you're six, right? Seven?
I was eight. I didn't play T-ball. I didn't go into coach pitch. I went straight in to International League,
let me get back to Little League. I'm very curious about this because I remarry, I get my vasectomy reversed. I'm a 90-year-old father with a 6-year-old kid, and I want him to play Little League, right?
Yeah.
All right. I
know that story.
I bring my 6-year-old to play Little League. Is there a 7-year-old pitcher now? An 8-year-old pitcher on the mound going up against my son or daughter who can automatically size up the kid and say, oh, this is a piker. He doesn't play catch with his father. I can strike him out in three pitches. Is that how sophisticated 9-year-old and 10-year-old little leaguers are these days?
How old is your kid? He's a 7-year-old playing against 9-year-olds?
I'm a 90-year-old guy. The kid
is playing against older kids.
No. He started, let's say, as I recall, my kids started playing Little League when they were 7. First grade.
Okay, T-ball. That's normal. Yes. But T-ball, and then I skipped T-ball. I was that good. I skipped T-ball. I went right into the 8-year-old International League, which is 45-foot mound.
Well, hang on for 1 second. So I have an 8-year-old kid, and I want them to start playing Little League, but I'm 90. I can't even pick up my own ball,
right?
Let alone play catch with my son. So he's in Little League, and he's going to go up at 8 years old, having never played baseball before, Little League before, and there's going to be a kid on the mound who's going to throw him a changeup and a fastball and play and know that he doesn't play catch with his father? He's going to be sized up?
Yeah, I would. I go, look at this kid. Look at this, you know, Jewish kid. I'm Jewish. All right? I read his energy. I'm not even going to throw him a changeup. I'm going to strike him out. 1, 2, 3. You're into video games. You're into swim class. I'm into baseball. I'm taking ground balls. I'm catching. I'm hitting. Where are you? You're at the amusement park. So now when you step on the plate against me, I strike you out. That's what you do.
There was a guy, he's friends with me on Facebook, Michael Conacow. He played for Lipton. That was the team in Little League. And he was, 8 years old, but he was a man. And he traumatized me. I played for Scholastic, the Little League team, growing up in Englewood. And he played for Lipton. And I have nightmares of having to go up against Michael Conacow because he had a fastball. So you're that good at 8.
You can be. Yeah. I mean, I had bad experience. Me personally, I wasn't like, I had some bad experiences too. I broke down on the mound. I've cried. I got accused of throwing at kids and I wasn't. And the umpire challenged me. He says, you were throwing at him. I go, no, I wasn't. And my coach really didn't defend me. I was kind of out there on my own. That was a traumatic experience for me. But I learned from that and made me stronger. And then the all-star coach, he taught me how to be a winner. He told me how to think. You're better. You're good. He taught me about the believing, the energy. Mm-hmm. And I saw from early on, going back to the warm-up, I saw what a winning, confident, and doing the work and having a little bit of passion and caring, you could win and be successful and help people's lives. And I saw that. And my coach, he had a son, and his son went on to be a major league coach. And I'm friends with my little league teammate, and now he's a coach with the Chicago Cubs. And all of that.
How are they doing these days? How are the Cubs doing?
They won the World Series.
I know.
You're joking, but yeah. he was with the Yankees, and that's the other thing. Joe Torre was an influence on my little league coach, so I learned from major. I learned from a major league. A point of view.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's like you're around major leaguers, you act like a major leaguer. You're around little leaguers or even college kids, you act like that. So I was around people, and through them, I was kind of living vicariously through major leaguers. So, and they won. That's the thing. You're hanging out with the major leaguers, and they were learning. My friend was learning from them, and now he's a major league coach, and he has 5 World Series rings. And I use that proof when I did the warm-up how positive energy and caring mattered, and I learned that also at Arizona State. So all these things I can kind of connect the dots, how baseball and comedy in my life are kind of intertwined.
Wow,
because it's just a matter of inches and millimeters and centimeters,
right,
with baseball,
right.
And the same thing with comedy, you can lose an audience.
Right. Laura House. Do you know Laura?
Yeah. From Texas.
Yeah. One of the, you know, she's one of these people, you find out she's considered one of the top transcendental meditators, teachers in the world. Not that it's a competition.
She is?
Yeah. Yep.
I did not know that.
Yeah, she teaches a type of meditation, and she's considered like Chris McGuire. You know Chris McGuire, right? The comedy. But he hires you all the time. And he's got, and he, by the way, great baseball name as well. Chris McGuire.
No relation to Mark.
I know, but it just sounds like he should be batting cleanup. So he told me, you realize that you're talking to one of the top teachers of transcendental meditation, Laura House. So she was on the show talking about creating neural pathways in your brain towards positive energy. And then the next day, I'm on John Fugelsang's show on Sirius, and he starts saying the same thing to me. Just the universe just was telling me, create neural pathways in your brain that lead you towards positive thinking. And as a pitcher, you can actually see the ball as a metaphor for a positive neural pathway. When you're thinking positive, when you're in the right groove, your baseball is a metaphor, as it goes to the catcher, is a metaphor for the positive energy neural pathway that we all need to develop in our brains.
Yeah, I mean, that goes back to what I learned with the visualization. It took me a while to get there, too, because my mind was too active when they would sit us down. This is 1988, close your eyes. And then it was the visualizing, but then it was also positive affirmations. And then you talk about the Tony Robbins, the Awaken the Giant Within. Of course I read that, some of it, about taking action. And when you play baseball, it's you're around these guys so much, you have to push each other. It gets you. I just saw the results of putting out good energy. And I think that I got picked on for it early on. I mean, it's so different. People aren't used to it. And I was like a nice kid. I think it's just about being nice, putting out positive energy. You're a nice kid, and nice kids can be, you know, picked on. So I think that's where some of my stand-up comes from. I don't want to be picked on anymore. And then I know that positive energy works, but I haven't been able to turn it into like, being positive doesn't mean like you're happy. I just know that energy matters. And when I did warm up, yes, I had to be in a good mood. I couldn't bring negative energy into the studio. Always had to bring positive energy in. But that doesn't mean I'm necessarily positive about everything. But yeah, when you're pitching, you have to be confident. You know, there's nothing like throwing a curveball and just strike a guy out, or to take a fastball and blow him away. And, you know, and I remember also hitting. There was nothing like hitting the ball. And so those moments, I get more, I mean, baseball's in my heart. I do comedy because people think I'm funny. I got pushed into comedy. I got pushed into stand-up through comedy trafficking school. You like that joke?
I think it's true, though. I think you, the improv, weren't you involved with the traffic school there?
No, I was in, I mean, I've done gigs there, but I didn't do comedy trafficking school. I did, that's funny. See, I can write jokes, David, but
Let me push you here. I want to stay on this. Jeff Garlin.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Early on in our friendship, he said to me, there are two gifts from God. The Andy Griffith Show. He said, you cannot be a happy man unless you understand the complexities of the Andy Griffith Show. And then he said, the real gift from God is baseball. Are you going through? Where are you? What does that sound?
That's Burbank. I'm under the flight path.
Oh, good.
Let's see. It's at Southwest. They're either going to Vegas. Yep, at Southwest. He's taking off. Yeah, they'll wrap around. That's going to Vegas.
Jeff Garlin said that baseball is a gift from God. Does positive energy lend itself to other sports? Could you be positive in boxing? Can you be positive in football? Or is this positive energy solely the domain of baseball when it comes to sports?
I think definitely baseball is being positive. Yes, it's a daily grind. It's you're around these guys all the time. You're playing football. It's 16 games. Who cares about being positive? Baseball's so individual. Everything is, you know, you're failing all the time. Basketball.
No, let's go back to stay with the positive energy. Okay. Stay with the positive energy.
I'm staying with the positive.
Can you, first of all, are you a fan of other sports besides baseball?
Yeah, I like basketball. I like football a little bit.
I would assume basketball and baseball are similar. You need positive energy with basketball as well.
Yeah, I mean, you're visualizing. You're in the zone, but you're also visualizing making the free throw, making the jump shot, blocking. You know, you can visualize that. That's not necessarily positive energy. I feel in life, positive energy matters. When you're playing the game, right in the middle of it, I don't know if, like, being positive matters. I think being confident, visualizing, I think even getting a little angry. I don't know if that's some people would say that's not positive. But if you get angry and that makes you throw the ball, like strike a guy out, you can do that. I can't do comedy angry. I could play baseball angry. You know, I can pitch. I would take it, even though I take the audiences personally when a guy's digging in on me, you know, and he wants to hit a home run or make me look bad, I'll strike him out. That's why I struck out. If you look at my stats, even at Arizona State, I struck out 28 batters in 23 innings. I always struck out guys. I wasn't the greatest pitcher ever, but I definitely was able to sniff the strikeout and get it.
And how does that feel?
Great. Better than getting the laugh.
Oh, I was just going to ask you that at the end of, you know, driving home from a comedy show, when you kill, you're sated. That's one thing about stand-up comedy, is when a comedian knows when he came close to killing, and they go home and they feel good and satisfied.
Yeah, satisfied.
So you can finish a baseball game as a pitcher and be satisfied.
Yeah. I got to take a leak here, David.
Let's pause. You want to pause?
I'm going behind a bush.
You're
going to hold on.
Okay, should I keep rolling for my listeners?
Sure.
Okay. Okay.
So, I gotta take a leak.
All right, we're talking to Brody Stevens. He is taking a leak
on a wall.
He's taking a leak on a wall. Both hands
behind the bushes.
Left hand, right hand. What do you hold?
I urinate with my right hand.
Okay, under or over?
But I.
Are you,
over.
Are you choking up on it?
I hold it like a drumstick.
Oh, you choke up
on
it.
Nobody's watching me.
You know what I do before?
Yes,
I put some donuts on mine before I pee to make it much heavier so that when I actually have to pee, I take the donut off, and then I have...
I'm still peeing, by the way.
Good. You have a nice flow. We're very strong.
But it is. I'm still going, David.
Still go.
Now it's on my ankles. It's
good.
Spritzing on my ankles. Okay, a couple shakes. And I'm back. I've emerged from the bushes, and I'm back.
Greatest moment ever on my podcast.
Oh.
This is a first, Brody.
I feel so much better now.
Well, we got to wrap it up. Thanks for being on the show.
Oh. Oh, the last, yeah, the last 5 to 8 minutes, I had to go, I had to go take a leak. You could tell. I was getting scatterbrained. That's what people should say. Why are you scatterbrained? What's bothering you? I got to take a leak. No, I thought you were just jittery.
Back to baseball.
Back to baseball.
You're pitching at ASU. That's some serious baseball.
Yeah.
How many people?
I guess it was.
How many people in the stands?
When I played on the team, anywhere from 1,500 for like a non-league early season game to 3,000 to 5,000 for an average Pac-10 game, and then like 5,000 to 8,000 for big games.
Okay. Now, you had not done stand-up comedy yet.
No.
You're pitching.
Yes.
Audience is watching your every move.
Yes.
Are you paying attention to the crowd?
Not really, to be honest with you. Now, I didn't get to pitch too many times in front of huge crowds like that. I would pitch in, 1,000 people, a couple times more than that. No. I mean, you can hear them, but I'm not zoning in on one person saying something. I'm trying to do the best job of pitching. But I think with anything, it takes me a little while to get comfortable, and I didn't have that kind of leash in college. So I feel like you got to get used to that stuff. It takes a little while to get used to it. And I was just scratching, and I had a scratch and claw all the time for baseball just to be on the team, whereas comedy kind of comes easy. It's kind of a natural thing. The only thing, I was a good competitor.
I want you to stay on my question. I want my questions answered.
Yes sir.
I love
what
you.
What was the question again?
First of all, I love you and thank you for doing this. And so you haven't done stand-up, but you're funny, right?
I think I'm funny. People tell me I'm funny. Yes.
You're on the mound. Your ears are not tilting towards the audience in any way. It's not even an audience, right? It's just
The times I pitched in front of a crowd over 1,000 people or 1,500 people, no. Baseball-wise or even comedy-wise, no. I could do that.
It's not
but
factored in.
A larger crowd, maybe I would feel the difference.
So when I watch a major league pitcher, he's not paying attention to the audience.
He might at first. They talk about spring training is, okay, everyone's good here. Then when you go to the major league games, the stadiums are bigger. There's extra, you got 3 decks of stands, 4 decks. And some guys, that kind of could freak them out. They all talk about in spring training, oh, he's doing great. Let's see how they play when they've got 3 decks in there. So that is a real hurdle for guys to get over. And there's some guys who I feel I'd be in that boat, who you bring them up, and maybe they're not ready for it. They're kind of, the limelight gets to them. All eyes on them. They go back down. It's just something with getting comfortable. It's like stand-up.
Yeah. So it is like the club comic who gets the Tonight Show. Same.
Yeah, I mean, you're getting your reps in. It's reps. And if you're not, college is very cutthroat, but in major leagues, you have minor leagues, so you can go in and get your reps. And I feel like with stand-up, they say it takes 7 to 8 years to find your voice, and you got to get those 10,000 hours in with anything to be an expert. But if you're in college, a competitive team, and you're not getting those opportunities as much, I felt like I said, a short leash. But I learned so much about life and in baseball through my playing my baseball.
Statistically speaking, in baseball, is there such a thing as the home field advantage?
I think the guy's looking at me where I took the leak.
Maybe that's
the neighbor.
Maybe that's his territory. Maybe he pees there, and now you're going to have to fight him for that territory. This is going to be good. Can you take him?
He's an older guy, but he had a power tool with him.
And by the sound of your urination, you have a power tool as well, my friend.
Hello. Yeah, I don't know where all this was coming. I don't know where all the pee was coming from.
Well, you were at Starbucks.
Yeah, but this is too much of an early morning urination. It could have been from, I went to Dunkin' Donuts yesterday. Maybe that was still in my system. But it felt great. You know, there's nothing like...
Can I tell you something?
Five times throughout the night.
Let me tell you something, my friend. And I know I speak for my entire male audience. When you were done ping, we all shared a communal tingle. We all just had this little shiver together when you were done. That's how great that pee was.
Yeah, it was a good one.
So statistically speaking, is there a home field advantage? Can they prove numerically, statistically, that teams win when they're playing in front of their home team, home crowd?
I think so. There's a result of positive energy, but yes, they do play better in front of a home crowd.
Is that because of the positive energy from, I'm going to say, the audience? Or is it because every baseball stadium is different and they understand the nooks and crannies of their home stadium?
I think there's a little bit of that, yes. The nooks and crannies, the familiarity, the routine. But I also feel like, cheering on, support, does matter. Fans matter. And there's people, anti-sports types who don't think that matters. I do.
You think fans matter?
I think having supportive fans matter, yes.
Okay, I was in Chicago the night the Cubs won the World Series. It was insanity.
Yep.
It was insanity. I've never seen anything like that in my life. And I remember thinking, if fans matter, then why haven't the Cubs won every year? Because nobody loves the Cubs. I think Cubs fans are the most loving, maybe too forgiving. Maybe that's what it is. Maybe they...
Okay. No, when I say fans matter, I'm not saying like necessarily in a good way. They can pick up on nervous energy. You could look at the Boston Red Sox, maybe how when they won for the first time back in 2004. But I'll talk about the Cubs since I'm close to that situation. Since the friend I grew up with is a coach with the Cubs.
But answer my question. Answer my question. Here's my question.
Okay.
Here's my question.
I'll answer it.
Here's my question because I am not knowledgeable about this stuff. Would you say, after listening to you, I'm beginning to, when you say fans matter, I've scolded, looked at people with scorn when they said, we did it, we did. And I go, you didn't do anything. You drank a beer. But did they do it? Can a fan lay claim to a World Series victory? Talking to you, I'm beginning to understand that maybe they can. Maybe they can love a team so much and support it so much and put out so much positive energy and support that it puts the team over the finish line. Is that what you're saying?
I am saying yes. I'm saying yes, but I'm also saying that is not the end-all, be-all. But I will say... fans, supportive fans do help. And I could explain the specific Chicago Cubs situation.
Yes, please
like
do. Yes.
Since I'm close to it.
Yes.
The Cubs, and I witnessed it. The Cub fans are very nice. They're friendly. They're Midwest friendly. And I was at the World Series. I went to one of the games. Now, here's the other thing. I was with the Yankees. I was around the Yankees for 12 years. I was around Yankee Stadium. I was around Yankee fans. I was around Northeast baseball. It's intense. It's real. It's life or death. And look at the Yankees, 27 World Championships. When my good friend was one of the coaches there, 4 World Series rings. So I saw the result of passion, smarts, and beliefs. And you know what? It's New York. It's like, if you can't make it here, you can't make it anywhere.
But that's negative.
You could make.
But isn't that negative energy? Billy Martin, Reggie Jackson.
That's before. I'm not talking Billy. I'm talking.
They were winning, but they were winning with negative energy.
They did. Yes, they did win with negative, and that may have been that was the time. Maybe that time in baseball, negative energy. That was before all the mental stuff started to come into play. But you make a good point, David. You make a good point. They won with negative energy. But look what happened in New York. It was in shambles after that.
The Bronx is burning.
Yeah.
They used the energy of the city.
They did, and they squeezed everything out of it. And then after that, Times Square was – the 80s in New York, it was a dangerous time from what I gathered. I don't know. The Yankees were – I mean, they've done stories on how the Yankees in that time, like that was the summer of Sam and all that stuff.
Yeah, 77.
So,
well, I want to get back to the Cubs, and I'm interrupting you about something I know nothing about. You're saying positive energy.
I'm saying positive energy.
Okay, let me
positive energy.
Okay, let me ask you a question. I'm going to have the chef Jeremiah Tower on the show next week. You and I have no idea who he is, but he created the modern food movement, Chez Panisse, Stars. And the genius of Jeremiah Tower is to use local food. He says if you live in West Virginia, you use the local ingredients because West Virginia has a smell and a taste, and you want to feed people the smells and the taste of West Virginia. So you have to use the grass-fed cows and the spices, because that's West Virginia. You'd be foolish to try to create French cuisine in West Virginia. Create West Virginia cuisine. Use that energy. And when you bring up the Yankees using negative energy, does a team win? Did Chicago win? Do you win the World Series because you're using the homegrown energy? Does a team win not just with positive energy, but by reflecting and living off, thriving off the energy of that town? Because we just said in 77, the Bronx was burning, New York was falling apart. Did Billy Martin, did Reggie Jackson, did George Steinbrenner succeed by tapping into the horror show of New York City?
I would say yes, definitely. Now that, I mean, that, and again, that might have been the end of that time. You know, it was the end of the 70s. We were coming into the 80s. And I think the 80s was all, that it started to be more health conscious. Jogging came into play, and sunshine and MTV. Negative, but that's another. The world is so negative now that you have to be positive. That's the way I look at it.
Go back to Chicago. Tell me about Chicago.
Okay, I'm going to tell you, I'm going to explain to Chicago for you. Chicago's positive energy. They're nice people, okay? Being nice doesn't win baseball games. Bringing energy doesn't guarantee wins. Bringing energy is great, but you have to have baseball. You have to have smart baseball minds. So the manager of the Cubs is a positive energy guy. He's positive energy towards his players. He's a manager. He manages people. Joe Maddon, the manager of the Cubs, comes from Arizona, that area, coaching. And he knows all about this positive energy. So then you have coaches. Now, the coaches, they don't have to tap into positive energy. They tap into mechanics. They tap into researching strategy. They tap into doing the computer work, all that stuff. Yeah, it helps if you're positive. That's what the manager does. But it's nice to have a pitching coach or maybe another coach on the staff who is that positive. You know, they have a good cop, bad cop relationship. Now, with the Cubs, I went to the World Series, one of the games. The Cubs, it was like game four. The Cubs were leading in the first inning. They had a home run. Everyone's going nuts. The second inning, the Cleveland Indians, they tied it, and then they took the lead. The whole stadium went quiet. It's like they panicked. The energy left. Nervous energy. Not even energy. Just kind of nervous energy, but just nerves took over the stadium. Now, because Joe Maddon is a positive energy guy, he protects his team from that nervous Nelly energy. Then you've got coaches who have a blue-collar work ethic. They don't give an F about the fans. I mean, they like them, don't get me wrong. They like the fans. But their main job, if you're a great coach, and that's where my friend comes into play, he was a winner. It dates back to Joe Torre. It dates back to Little League winning. He's a winning guy. And then when you apply that with a positive energy guy, and then you take a blue-collar, raised in the 80s Valley guy, that's what it took to get the Cubs over the top. I'm telling you, I was there, and they won in spite of the nervous energy that the Cub fans were bringing. I witnessed it. So the Cubs are positive amongst themselves, and that comes from the coach, the manager. Then you've got the guys who are actually, you know, right there. There is, you know, the general manager doesn't have to be positive. He's there to do his job and put the best coaches and the best play in the position to win. The manager, he's the positive energy guy. He's touching the players every day. He's around them. So he's positive, but you got to have some guys who are just no baseball, old school, and they don't give an F about fan experience. And that's what it takes to be a winner. Still have fun, but it's about winning. If you win, your life is better. Everybody's happier. It creates memories. I saw it. You saw what happened in Chicago. Winning created all those memories for people. So when people say sports are bad or it's not about winning, winning did matter, because look what it did to those families in Chicago. And it took a blue-collar guy from the Valley, who was my teammate in Little League, to get the Cubs a championship. Wow. His work ethic, my positive energy, brought Chicago and the Cubs their championship.
My last question about baseball, and then we'll wrap it up. We're having Jeremiah.
I know I was stretching, by the way, but go ahead. I was stretching.
Physically stretching.
Physically, I'm on the curb right now and doing calf raises. But I truly believe when you talk, honestly, I'm not saying I hung out with the Cubs. I was in the parade. I was around them. They need an energy guy. Every team has psychologists. They have mental skills coach. It's a real thing.
Wow. Wow. I go to a baseball, I go to a baseball game and I'm relaxed. It's joyous. I beat myself up for not going to more baseball games. And I say, what's wrong with me? Why can't I relax? Yada, 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 yada. You go to a baseball game. Now, last week I saw this documentary, The Last Magnificent. It's about Jeremiah Tower. We're going to have him on the show. He revolutionized American cuisine. I hung on every frame.
What's up? Good. Got recognized or something.
Yeah, officer, that's the guy who pissed on my wall.
I don't know what it was. I think they said the guy from The Hangover. I don't know.
Oh, wow. Well, okay, so I hung on every frame of that movie. And if somebody was talking, if somebody interrupted me, shut the F up. I'm watching this. I'm hanging on every millisecond of this documentary. You go to the World Series. Brody Stevens goes to the World Series in Chicago. Are you hanging on every second of that game?
I should be. But Yeah, of course I want the Cubs to win. I feel like...
What I'm saying is there so much to watch, because you know so much about the game, that your mind is just isolating moments and players and anticipation and strategy? Is that what's going on? When you sit in the stands and watch a baseball game, you're looking at it far differently than I am, right? I mean, is it possible that you don't want anybody talking to you, that you can be totally immersed in a game without your mind ever wandering? You know how people gamble because they're totally in the moment and focused on one specific thing. When you go to a baseball game, can you be completely focused on the game?
Well, my yes and no. I like the culture of baseball. I like baseball food. I like being around foul balls. I like sometimes the game operations. They're fun. But in terms of like strategy, that sort of thing, it was never my... I'm not really into strategy. I like the culture of baseball. I like being around it. I don't love sitting in the stands, and I like the pregame. I like being around that. I mean, I'll watch a game on. It's always background information for it's background noise.
But I'm talking about this. Okay, part of my, okay, hang on for one second.
Okay, yeah.
Okay,
I could have answered that better.
No, that's all right. I'm not being rude. I'm just curious. If you get me to play blackjack, there is nothing you can tell me when I'm playing blackjack that will get my mind off the cards. If I'm watching a movie that I'm into, there's nothing you can say. The house is on fire. I don't care. I want to see this movie. Total, absolute focus. If I'm doing stand-up or talking to you right now, I am totally focused on Brody Stevens right now, to the exclusion of everything else in my life. It's a great escape for me. Is baseball doing that for you? Is baseball complete focus on a game? The way you...
No.
Okay.
No. I like the culture of baseball, the game itself, the strategy. I appreciate it, but I'm not locked in on everything. I'm more locked in, yes, if I'm playing the game, pitching, or doing comedy, I can't have those distractions. But sitting in a crowd, going to a game, I could talk. I'm relaxed. But I also, it's kind of cool knowing that I know these guys, I'm around them. But I've been to so many, here's the other thing. I've been to so many baseball games over the year. You could take a year off from baseball, it will always be there. For me, being around, it's not that relaxing. I'm not relaxed around baseball. So it's hard for me actually to, sometimes you got to take a break. Sometimes I want to be a fan and just buy a ticket. And then other times I can call down and maybe get a ticket or get a pass, but that's stressful. Being around baseball at the major league level is kind of stressful because you have to behave a certain way. And I'm not getting paid by these guys. I'm not working for the baseball team. So the more you're around them and the more comfortable you are, then you start saying like, well, I'm not getting paid. I like being around
it.
That's why I've been trying to work in a job, trying to try to tie in comedy and baseball for me.
I want to get back to baseball in one second. If you go to if you go to a boxing match, you're hanging on every moment. If say Sandy Koufax goes to a baseball game, can he be completely focused on the game to the exclusion of anything else? Could you, if you really wanted to, go to a baseball game or watch a baseball game on television and block out the world? Because I know you can do that with boxing.
Yes, I could. Playoff game. Yes, I can. For a playoff game or a no-hitter or something like that, but a regular... you know, a game like today, am I going to be locked in on every pitch? No.
But if you were,
I won't be.
If you were gambling on it,
that would be different.
Yeah.
Yeah. If you're gambling on it, you probably locked in. Luckily, I don't have that gambling
right
gene. But for me, baseball is, it's a lifestyle. I like the culture. I'm not totally, like I said, into strategy. I just like, I like what baseball teaches. I like that. I like that there's Little League. I like that it's respects tradition. So I think it's, I feel like I go to games, it's kind of like I'm doing my part. I feel like if you live in this country, you should be mandatory to go to like two baseball games a year, just so you see how everything is. You appreciate things, appreciate the weather, appreciate athletics, appreciate the workers. I don't know, everything. I just feel like baseball is something we should keep, even though it's a little, it can be boring, but when you're pitching, it's not boring. That's the thing. You're around the action.
Oh, when Jeff Garland said to me, baseball's a gift from God, it is truly the American sport because it teaches you that we're all in this together. We're competing, but we're all in this together. We're competing against another team. You have to learn to wait your turn. You'll get your turn to shine. You'll also get your turn to chip in on the defense in order to protect each other. We all have to assist one another. But if you work hard enough, you'll get your turn to shine. But in the end, it's the team that wins. We've lost that spirit in America. That's why baseball is becoming less and less popular, because the morality of baseball has escaped us.
I agree. I think baseball is kind of bouncing back. I think now that they're athletes, they're so much, these kids are better. You watch them play, they're fast. They're faster than the game now. So it's like arena baseball. Whereas before, you'd see the players, there was like, you know, you're like your dad out there. That's what the culture was. Now, these kids are, they're like basketball players. They're CrossFit guys. So you're seeing young kids playing, and baseball is making a real effort, a real push to get, you know, different communities involved. And I think baseball is trending up. And I also just, it's got a great app on the, you know, the app is popular, but they're not going after people who have the baseball app. But I just feel that as long, you know, football with the injuries, and then basketball, you know, basketball's still popular, but that's definitely got to be physical in that. Baseball's a one sport. You could still be a small, tiny guy and be successful.
We've been talking with Brody Stevens. His new podcast is called Festival of Friendship. I don't want to say it's new, but it's, you had one before, right?
Well, it's the same one. I just don't do it consistently enough. The Festival of Friendship on the Feral Audio Network. I've done about 90 episodes.
Mm-hmm. So everybody should download that. And you have a comedy...
Yeah, download it.
You have a comedy special coming out on CISO later in this year, right?
Yes, I do. We shot a one-hour special at the Comedy Store, a late-night conceptual piece showing what happens when you're the last guy at the Comedy Store. How do you... deal with that. People tired, people having to go pay for babysitters, avoid parking tickets. And I'm trying to, you know, have them listen to my latest, you know, joke, my latest tweet. Come back here.
Right.
I'm going to read this funny tweet to you.
Right. And you're always at the Comedy Store. How's Adam doing?
Adam Egan's doing great. Now, you want another, you want to hear an interesting thing?
Yeah.
David?
Yes, sir.
Adam Egan, right? He runs the Comedy Store?
Yeah.
Adam Egan grew up with me. Adam Egan was a camper at the Joe Torre baseball camp. Adam Egan grew up. His family grew up with the family of the coach of the for the Chicago Cubs, Mike Borzello. So the same guy who taught me about winning as a kid in the late 70s, early 80s, helped raise the man today that turned the Comedy Store around.
Yes.
That's where baseball and comedy are intertwined. The guy who runs the comedy store was the same kid who I taught how to throw a baseball. And now he runs the comedy store.
And it's all positive. All positive energy. All positive energy. He, right?
I mean, honestly, a lot of it.
Yes.
It is.
Yeah.
Belief, like, Adam grew up in the Valley. People picked on the Valley in the 80s. Valley Girl, Karate Kid. So we had a sense of pride in the Valley. And Adam is part of that last generation, that last connection to the 80s generation of the Valley. And look at me, a one-hour special. I'm doing the David Feldman podcast. I've got my own podcast. Adam turned around the comedy store. So there is something to that.
Oh, my
I
God.
Really
yes,
I mean, I know it's sounding corny,
No.
There's
You know, I've been living in New York for a couple of years, and I went back and went to the comedy store, and he's running it. And all of a sudden, I'm going, what happened to the ghosts of the dead gangsters when this place was Ciro's? Adam purified it. Right?
Yeah. Adam's energy. Adam's late 80s San Fernando Valley blue-collar work ethic energy.
Mm-hmm.
Turned the comedy store around. I've been there since 2000. I wrote it out. I was able to stay away from the darkness, but I kept bringing my positive energy in. And then the comedians started, even the door guys, just the culture of the comedy store changed.
Right.
And
if you want
a great place to be,
if you want to learn more about Adam, read Norm MacDonald's book. And go watch the Norm MacDonald podcast on YouTube. And Adam is his sidekick, and he's hysterical. Brody Stevens.
Yeah, Adam's good.
Brody Stevens, I love you. I really would love you to come back and teach me about baseball. I want to be a better human being, and I want to learn how to have a baseball game going on all the time in the background. I remember Groucho Marx, before he died, waxing poetic about Vin Scully. I remember he said, there are very few women in my life who I love. There are very few people I can trust. I guess the only person I really, really worry about is Vin Scully. He said, without Vin Scully, this is what Groucho said. He said, if I were to lose Vin Scully, my life would be over. And I've always felt as a comedian and as a human being, there's something lacking in me for not being able to appreciate baseball on a much deeper level. And I thank you for taking time to explain baseball to me, and I'd love you to come back. Thank you.
Are you getting emotional, David?
But this was a great episode. This is exactly the way I wanted it to go. I wanted to talk to you about baseball, and I got exactly what I wanted from you, so I thank you.
Awesome. Yeah, I had a good time. It was longer than 3 minutes, and that's okay.
and you made history
urinated.
On the show. Yeah, you made history. You made it. Nobody has ever urinated on my show.
Yeah.
I've made people throw up.
Yeah.
I've made people sick to their stomach, but I've never... We've never had somebody urinate on the show. That's pretty good.
It was real.
What are you going to do today, sir? What are your plans?
I have therapy at 5 o'clock above the Hamburger Hamlet in Van Nuys. what else? I'm calling in my avails to the comedy store. That's on my to-do list.
Uh-huh.
And I already showered.
Mm-hmm.
I was in Arizona over the weekend, so it's my first day back. But probably do some. We're still editing some things. I'll do some push-ups, apple cider vinegar.
And you're doing?
I'm feeling good. Go ahead.
No, and you're going to be in Iowa for the comedy festival, and then there's a big festival coming up.
Yes. Exactly. There's a new festival. It's in Iowa. It's on Memorial Day, I believe.
Wow.
So later on this month, I need to get my plane tickets. I need to get that settled. And then maybe another festival. I love festivals. The summer, I love doing comedy outdoors. I really do. daytime outdoors.
That goes against everything I believe. How can you do
shorts?
How can you do comedy outside in the sun? That doesn't make any sense.
I know it doesn't, but I was able to do it. And you, if you were on the show, you would have a good time and you would get laughs also. Not that you don't, but I could get you having a great time outdoors in shorts in the middle of the summer getting laughs. Positive energy.
Yeah, I have to say, being in Iowa on Memorial Day, that to me is as American as it gets.
Yeah, and guess what? The Field of Dreams field in the corn is near where this festival is. So I'm going to go check out the Field of Dreams.
When you say from the movie, but that's not a true story. That's from the movie, right?
Right, it's the movie, but it's there. The Field of Dreams is there. And I actually did, on my TV show, Enjoy It, on Comedy Central, I did a whole thing based off Field of Dreams, where I was in Fenway Park in Boston, and that's where I was taping my half-hour special. And it was a symbolic transfer from my I was putting down my baseball glove and picking up the microphone.
Wow.
And that happened I did that at Fenway Park, and I sat in the stands, and I kind of recreated that scene from Field of Dreams.
I'm going to end on a negative note, a confession.
Uh-oh.
This is a religious... You're going to be my father confessor, my umpire, my manager. I have to change as a human being. I saw Field of Dreams... I'm so ashamed. I'm so ashamed to tell you this. I saw Field of Dreams in San Francisco, and there was a morbidly obese woman sitting behind me, weeping throughout the movie. And I was infuriated because I was with my friend, and I was going, she has no right to be weeping. She's morbidly obese. What does she know about sports, running and hitting? What sense? Why is she crying? Is it because it's a cornfield and corn was cut down to make way for a baseball field? Is that why she's crying, for the lost corn syrup that she's not ingesting? And she's just weeping throughout the entire movie. And finally, I complained to the usher. I went. There were ushers back then, and I said, there's a woman weeping, and you have to tell her to shut up, because she's fat, and she's eating popcorn, and she cares more about the corn fields than she does baseball. She has no right to be here. That's not true. I didn't really say that to the usher, but I wanted to.
Yeah.
I switched seats. The truth is, I was with a friend, and I felt that she was crying about the cornfields and not this beautiful moment between a father and the son. And I switched seats, and the movie was ruined for me. And whenever it comes on and I try to rewatch it, I think of this morbidly obese woman crying, and I get angry again. Because crying is just as bad as talking during a movie.
Would it help you to know that maybe she was wheezing?
Thank you,
deviated
Brody.
Septum.
Thank you, Brody Stevens.
You got it, David. Thank you.